Hello friends, I am your friend Shadab Imam and we are continuing our lecture series on operations research. So today we are going to do another production planning problem, and it is a very unique problem and it may seem difficult at first, but once you are clear with your concept, it is quite easy to formulate this problem. So let us start the problem. It says that a company manufacturing air coolers has at present firm orders for next 6 months. The company can schedule its production over the next 6 months to meet the orders on either regular or overtime basis. The order size and the production cost over the next 6 months are as follows. Okay, so here in this question it says that a company manufacturing air coolers has the orders for the next 6 months and it has to schedule its production. So in this matrix it has given that there are months 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, and the corresponding orders for first month the order is 640, second month it is 660, third month it is 700, 750, 550 and 650. Okay, now the cost of production, that is regular time production, working on a regular time basis is given and working on overtime basis is given. So for all 6 months, regular time production is given as for first month it is 40, for second month 42, then 41, 45, 39, 40 respectively. Similarly, cost of overtime production is also given. For first month it is 52, then 50, 53, 50, 45 and 43. Now it also says that with 100 coolers in stock at present, that means before starting the schedule it already has 100 coolers in stock, the company wishes to have at least 150 coolers in the stock at the end of 6 months. That means once the 6 month is completed, it must have at least 150 number of air coolers. Okay, the regular and the overtime production in each month. Okay, remember, as I told, in each month, we have to notice this keyword, in each month is not to exceed 600 units and 400 units respectively. Okay, the inventory carrying cost for air coolers is rupees 12 per unit per month. That means, so first of all, what inventory carrying cost is? Inventory is nothing but the stock they hold to for the maintenance of that particular stock. The inventory carrying cost is the term inventory carrying cost is used. Inventory itself means stock. So to for the maintenance of inventory, the cost incurred is termed as inventory carrying cost. So inventory carrying cost for air coolers per unit per month, that means per unit in 1 month, rupees 12 is needed. Now we need to formulate the linear programming model to minimize the total cost. So here our objective is to minimize the total cost. Okay, so first of all, let us have a macro level to of this question so that we understand what is the what is the source of this question. So it says that a company has order for next 6 months, these are the corresponding orders, and they have regular time and overtime production cost for each month. Each month has a regular, has a different regular time cost and a different overtime cost. Okay, now let us start solving problem. I am going to erase this portion so that I could solve here. So in this question, we need to understand what our decision variables would be. So in order to decide the decision variables, we need to think of our objective. As we have discussed now, that in this question, our objective is to minimize the cost. Okay. So our objective is to minimize the total cost. So first of all, we need to find out what our total cost is. So total cost will have the number of units produced in first month on regular time basis and overtime basis. Summation of this, then number of units produced in the second month on regular time basis and overtime basis, the summation of this. Similarly with third month, fourth month, fifth month and sixth month, and we are going to add up all. Apart from this cost, we also have an inventory carrying cost for each month. That means for first month we have certain inventory carrying cost, for second month, for third month, up to sixth month. So what actually our decision variables should be? So I'll take a term, let xij be the number of units of air coolers produced in jth month. So J I am taking here as month. So as we know there are 6 months, so that means J can be equal to 1, 2, 3 up to 6. So J can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6, it can be any of these. Similarly, number of units of air coolers produced in jth month on regular or overtime basis. That is I. Okay. I here indicates it may be regular or overtime. That means I can be either 1 or 2. So here 1 I will be taking for regular time production and 2 I will be taking for overtime production. Okay, so let me explain you another way. X I J here, in this X I, that means I in this portion represents regular time or overtime. For regular time I will take I equals to 1 and for overtimes I will take I equals to 2. Okay, similarly J is the month in which it is going to produce. So J can be 1 or 2 or up to 6, it can be any of these. So it is clear. Now apart from these, we need to identify what are our inventories at the end of each month. Suppose after first month, what will be the inventory? After second month, what will be the inventory? That means what is the actual stock present at the end of that particular month. So let us have another variable, which is yj. Yj be the number of units of air coolers at the end of month. Now here I am taking J for month, that means J can be equals to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and up to 6. That means for if I am considering Y1, that means inventory at the end of first month. If I consider Y2, that means inventory at the end of second month. Similarly Y3 for inventory at the end of third month. Similarly 4th, 5th and 6th month. Okay, so these are our decision variables and we have judicially described our decision variable, what it is. Again, let me explain once again, because this is only the confusing part and student may get confused in this portion. So for a regular time, suppose we are producing a certain number of units in first month, that means I will write this as x11. That means number of unit produced in first month, this one is for regular time or overtime. So one is for regular time, that means the amount of unit produced by regular time in first month. Similarly, if I write x21, that means number of unit produced by overtime in first month. Similarly, for the second month, I will have x12, that means number of unit produced by regular time in second month. Similarly, x22, that means number of unit produced by overtime in second month. Similarly, we will have x13 and x23. Similarly, x15 and x25. Similarly, x16 and x26. Is it clear? So now what our total cost will be? Total cost should be the number of units produced by regular cost or regular time. So in the first month, the number of unit produced by regular time is x11, and the total regular time cost is 40. So it is 40 x11. Okay, similarly for second month, it is 42 x12. Similarly for third month, it is 41 x13. Similarly for fourth month, it is 45 into x14. Similarly fifth month, 39 x15. Similarly 40 x16. So this total is the cost incurred for 6 months of production by regular time. Similarly, we need to calculate the total amount that is spent in overtime basis. So for overtime, we can see that the cost for first month is 52 and the number of unit produced is x21, that means by overtime basis on first month. So it is 52 x21 plus 50 x22 plus 53 x23 plus 50 x24 plus 45 x25 plus 43 x26. Okay, so from here to here, the total cost shows that this is a cost by overtime basis. Okay, cost on overtime basis. Similarly, now we have another cost, which are inventory carrying cost. So for first unit, for first month, inventory at the end of month will be Y1. Similarly, for second month, it is Y2. So inventory for all the units, all the 6 months will be Y1 plus Y2 plus Y3 plus Y4 plus Y5 plus Y6. Okay, so this is the inventory, and inventory carrying cost per unit per month is given as rupees 12. So we will multiply this by 12. Okay, I'm adding this plus. So we can easily see this, that this is the total regular time cost. It is up to here. This is total regular time cost. This is total overtime cost. And this is total inventory cost. Combining these three together, we will have the total cost of production, and we need to minimize this total cost. We will minimize Z equal to this. So this will be our objective function. Okay, now once we finally get our objective function, we will see what our constraints are. So in the lower portion, previously we have written, it has been specially mentioned that the regular time production in each month should not exceed 600 units, and the overtime production in each month should not exceed 400 units. So now we'll see that what are the production in regular time. So in regular time, production are x11, x12, x13, x14, x15 and x16. So x11, x12, x13, x14, x15, x16. So these are the individual production rate in each month: first month, second month, third month, fourth month, fifth month and sixth month by regular time, and this should not exceed 600 unit. So this is our first constraint. Similarly, it has been mentioned that the overtime production in each month should not be less, should not exceed 400 units. So what are the production by overtime? X21, X22, X23, X24, X25, X26. Okay, these are the number of units produced by overtime basis. So X21, X22, X23, X24, X25, X26. And these should not exceed 400 units. So this is our second constraint. Now, next, what it has been given is, I'm just rubbing this so that I can write other constraints here. Okay, now it has been given that inventory carrying cost for per unit per month is rupees 12. The initial inventory is 100 units. That means before starting, we have 100 units available here. This is inventory at the start of first month, not at the end of first month. And we have also given that the end of 6 months, the inventory should be at least 150. That means we will calculate the inventory. So what inventory is? The total amount produced. The total amount produced, suppose if I consider for first month, we will produce X11 plus X21. That means for first month by regular time and first month by overtime. These two plus what was inventory before first month. So it is 100. So these two minus the order consumed in first month. So I can say that 100 is the inventory at the start of first month. Okay, and in first month we have X11 plus X21. This is the production we have. This is by regular time, this is by overtime, and among these minus 640. This is the order that has to be fulfilled. That means we will reduce this, and the remaining portion, that means this portion, is equal to Y1 is the inventory at the end of first month. Okay, similarly for the second month, we will have Y1 inventory at our hand. So at the starting of second month, the inventory available at the end of first month will be available at the starting of second month. So Y1 is available at the starting of second month, and the number of units produced in second month is X12 plus X22. That means number of units produced by regular time in second month, number of units produced by overtime in second month, minus the order to be fulfilled on the second month, that is 660. This is 660. This has to be equal to Y2. That means this is the total amount for second month minus this order is fulfilled. So the inventory available at the end of second month is Y2, which is the difference of this. Similarly, inventory available at the end of second month will be available at the start, at the beginning of third month. That means Y2 is available at the beginning of third month. Now this plus the number of units produced in third month. So in third month we have X13 plus X23. Okay, that means number of units produced by regular time in third month, number of units produced by overtime in third month. This is the total number of units available minus the order that needs to be fulfilled, that is 700 minus 700. This has to be equal to Y3. Okay, similarly, inventory Y3 is the inventory available at the end of third month. So this will be available at the beginning of fourth month. So Y3 or Y4 is available, or I think I should write here, Y3 is the inventory available at the beginning of fourth month, plus the units produced in the fourth month is 14 plus X24 minus the order consumed in the fourth month is 750. This has to be equal to Y4. Y4 is the inventory available at the end of fourth month. Now this inventory will be available at the beginning of fifth month. So Y4 plus the number of units produced in the fifth month is X15 plus X25. Okay, now this is the number of units produced, or this is the number of units available in the fifth month, and now the demand to be fulfilled is 550. So we will subtract 550. We will have Y5, which is the inventory at the end of fifth month. Similarly, Y5 is available at the beginning of sixth month. That means Y5 plus the number of units produced in sixth month is X16 plus X26. That means number of units produced by regular time in sixth month, number of units produced by overtime in sixth month, minus the number of units need to fulfill, that is 650. 650. This is equal to Y6. So Y6 is the inventory available at the end of sixth month. Now, so Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4, Y5, Y6, these all constraints are mentioned. Now, there is one more constraint. It is given in the question that inventory at the end of sixth month, at the end of its sixth month is Y6. Inventory at the end of sixth month is at least should be at least 150 units of air coolers. That means Y6 has to be greater than equal to 150. That means at least, because it is saying at least 150, that means Y6 has to be either 150 or more. Now we have mentioned our constraints. Okay, now to show non-negativity restriction, I am writing it here that xij should be greater than equal to 0. Similarly, yj should be greater than equal to 0. Okay, so we have mentioned the decision variables at the beginning. Then we have identified the objective function, which is the total cost, and the total cost consists of total regular time production cost, total overtime production cost, plus total inventory cost. So this, the sum of these three is the total cost. And the constraint shows that the first two constraints are specifically shown, and it shows that the production by regular time in each month has to be less than equal to 600, and the number of units produced by overtime in each month should be less than equal to 400. Okay, then we have calculated inventory for each month, Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4, Y6, what should be the inventory. And then the last constraint, which is shown that the inventory at the end of 6th month should be greater than equal to 150 units. And after that, we have implied the non-negativity restriction, which is Xij should be greater than equal to 0 and Yj should be greater than equal to 0. That means all the units produced in each month, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, can be 0 or positive. It cannot be negative. So this was the last question in our formulation series. In the next lecture, we will start solving the linear programming problem by graphical method. And in graphical method, we will learn how to solve by graphical method, what are the limitations of graphical method, and we will do some exceptional cases also, which is very important for concept building and for the competitive exams like GATE and ESE. So if you like our lecture, please subscribe the channel and don't forget to hit the like button. Okay, thank you and have a nice day.